Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this live event. This is lesson number 39 from the Java Fundamentals stream and we are discussing Stream API. So this set of packages and classes, this functionality came with Java 8 and was a little bit enhanced in Java 9. We'll discuss it in a series of lessons. So this is only the first part because the subject is a complex one, but is an important subject as well for your real world scenarios and for your OCP 11 exam questions. So you need to know this subject as much in detail as possible, especially if you want to attend that OCP 11 exam. But you will work a lot with Stream APIs in practice as well, because as you will see, it is a great alternative for several pieces of code to write them, let's say, in a shorter manner. Because as you will, as we'll discuss in these lessons related to the Stream API, the Stream API doesn't necessarily add more performance to your application, but they for sure make your code way more maintainable if you know how to write your instructions. So that's why we discuss them, and that's why they represent an important subject again that you really need to know if you work with Java. So I have already created here my project, which is using Java 14, but we mainly discuss about the features up to Java 11, which is the latest long-term supported. Anyway, as I've told you already, the latest changes in the Stream API that I know were with Java 9. So we discussing about Java 11 or Java 9 or Java 14 in this regards would be the same thing. So don't forget, if you are watching the event live, you have a live chat there, so you can ask questions directly in the live chat. If not, if you are watching the video recorded afterwards and you have questions, you can leave them in the comment section. You can use the discussion section or the community section of the channel, or you can find me on LinkedIn or Twitter and we can discuss directly there. So with that being said, I think we can just continue with our first example. I will give you a first example in code and then I will write a short diagram, because I want to make very sure with a visual that I really explain in detail how streams are working. I want to be sure that you really understand correctly what Stream API is, and then of course with all the rest of the examples that we'll do, you will for sure understand all the details that you need to know in regards to this subject. So let's start with a first example. I will create here a first class example one, and inside my first class I will have the public static void main method, and let's assume I have a list declared. I will simply declare a list of integers and let's call it list. I use the list of factory method that I have available with Java 9, and I add some numbers here. The order is not important. But mind that I have here some odd as well as some even numbers. So I have a 1 and a 5, they are odds, a 3, it's odd as well, a 9, which is odd, and then I have a 6 and an 8, and they are even. So what I want is to, for example, in my case, print out only the even numbers of the list. So I will just take first the approach in which I used a very small piece of code using a normal loop and normal decisional structures that we have learned in the past lessons to filter out and print only the even numbers. And then I will show you how this goes with a Stream API, that you get a feeling about that. And then I will tell you how the Streams API work in a visual, and then we will continue with more examples, because we will have a lot of things again to learn about the Stream API itself, a lot of methods and a lot of things to be discussed there. You will see that we will make a great use of the functional API, the Java util function interfaces we have discussed in just the previous lesson. So if you missed that, you can anytime review it on the same channel. So if I am to print only the even numbers, then using, for example, a simple for loop, I can take all the numbers from the list and then I can use a decisional structure like an if to find out which of them are even and which of them are odd. So I can simply take each of them and try to divide them by 2, and in case the modulo will give us a 0, then we can draw the conclusion that this is an even number, so we just print it. And this is the way you would do without the streams. So of course, if you run this, we can run it, you will see it's nothing, just a very small piece of code that prints out the even values from this list here. What we want now is to change this and make it work the same, but with a stream API approach. So instead of having this for and decisional structure if, I will basically take out a stream from the list, which, as we'll discuss in detail later, you do by calling the stream method from any collection, and then you apply different intermediary methods. One of them is called filter, and you didn't see because I was too fast, but filter receives a predicate as a parameter, and I want to refer to the fact that the filter receives a predicate because now theoretically you know what a predicate is, because we have discussed this in just the previous lesson. So you remember, if you remember, predicate is that functional interface that receives a value and always returns true or false. It's like a function, but if a normal function receives something and returns something, and we can decide both of these somethings, like the type of them can be different and we decide them from the beginning with the generic types, with a predicate we only can decide the type of the input, but we don't decide the type of the output, because the output will always be a boolean. And that's one of the functional interfaces we discussed in the previous lesson, together with other 8 very important core functions that I've told you it's really important to remember. And then if you remember those, you know all the 30 something functional interfaces from the Java util function package. So predicate was one of them, and in this case, guess what, it actually receives an integer, and the reason for that is because the stream was applied to a list which has integer here. So the elements that are going out from this stream are the elements from this list, which are of course integers. And that's why here I will apply the filter, and I will define my predicate. If you remember again, the predicate, being a functional interface, we will always refer it, implement it through a lambda expression, and this lambda expression has to receive a parameter. It's that parameter, that value on which we apply the predicate, and at the right side of the arrow operator of lambda expression, we have to return a boolean. So we need an expression here that can be evaluated with a boolean. In our case, of course, you have guessed, is precisely this one, because what we do with this filter, what does this filter method actually do, is to make sure after it only pass the values that respect the predicate. That means the values for which the predicate returns true. So once they've passed the filter, we know in this case that the values respect the predicate, which means that they are even numbers. So the only thing we need to do now is take each of them, and we do this using the for each method, and we can, for example, print them in the console, because this was basically what we were doing previously in the small demonstration above that we are rewriting with streams. And now I want to show you another thing. If you were attentive to when I've called the for each method, you have seen that this for each method receives a consumer as a parameter, and this consumer again should ring a bell, because it's one of those interfaces we discussed in the previous lesson, in lesson 38. So if you missed lesson 38, where we discussed all these nice and important functional interfaces, remember, you can anytime go back and review the recording on this channel. The consumer is that interface that defines an object that consumes a value but doesn't return anything. So in case of a consumer, we will consume a value, so we receive that value through the parameter, but we don't return anything. The generic type of a consumer is the type of the value consumed by the consumer, which of course in this case is again integer, because we have a list of integers, so what we will consume here are integers. Basically, you know, for each also is the same name, the method, the collections have also directly. So in my case, I use the for each here from the stream interface that we'll discuss soon. But also the collections, if you remember, have a similar method, at least a method named the same for each, which receives as a value a consumer and is used to consume all the values from the collection. So this is a very, very similar method, but it's from the stream interface and is part of the stream API. And of course here, then I will write it like this to be very clear that we consume the value, and then we can do the same thing we were doing here. We can print it out in the console. That's what should happen on the right side of the lambda expression. So this is the consumed value, and this is what happens when the value is consumed. And if you remember, because we have discussed in one of the previous lessons that we have this method reference operator, that two colons, one of the places where you can use that, maybe you remember, if not I will show you now, is when what's on the left side of the lambda operator in terms of parameters are the same and in the same order as what you provide to the method on the right side of the lambda expression. So it's exactly as in our case here, where x is consumed as a parameter of the lambda expression, but you provide it directly to the method. If you want to rewrite this using the two colon operator, again appeared with Java Java 8 6 years ago, then you can avoid completely writing the lambda expression together with the parameter, and then you don't need to write the parameter as well, but you need to replace this differentiation of the method with the two colon operator. And that's basically the same thing with writing x system out print line of x. So this call here is the same one with the one in the comment now, and of course I can comment this out completely now, and you will basically see that my stream implementation does precisely the same thing. For such a short piece of code, it might not look very interesting, because you don't see a great benefit. You will still see we have 3 or 4 lines of code. You might see that we avoid writing a lot of curly braces here, we avoid some boilerplate code, but it's not that much as in the case of a bigger block of code. So if we had a larger code snippet here, the larger the snippet is, usually the more efficient is to write and read using Stream API. So even if now with what we have here as our first example, it doesn't look like very interesting, like it doesn't look like it it's easier to read, you will see again the more you write to your code snippet, the easier it is to read it when you put it in a Stream API expression like this one. And that simply comes from the fact that the Stream API, if you even put it like this one under the other, it's even easier to read it up to down, top to bottom, word by word what's happening. So you read, I have a list, and then I filter the elements and I take each one of them and I do something. So you can simply read it like poetry. It's much more easier than if you have firstly seen this and then you evaluate the expressions here in a procedural way of thinking. Here you have some words that you simply read, which makes the things more easy to understand, and that basically makes your code cleaner and easier to maintain. That being said, let's try to create a short visual to them to explain you how the streams work before going to the next examples and to start working on the Streams API methods that you should know. I want first to make sure that you understand precisely how this works. So the streams always have at least two parts. One of them is called the source. So I will call this the source and I will note it with a big S here. The source is the place where the values come from. So we need always some values to be processed. And that's why we need a source. And there is no stream without having a source. And that's the place again where the values being processed are coming from. It can be a collection, or it can be an expression defining the way the elements are produced. We will see multiple ways to define the source, but very important for the moment is to remember that the source is mandatory. And then we need at least one operation, and that is called the terminal operation. So I will define this terminal operation with a T here. And again, this is mandatory. A stream without a terminal operation doesn't execute. Some of the operations that we will learn, defined by some of the methods we will discuss, are terminal operations. When you call a terminal operator, there is no stream after the terminal operator. The stream always closes in the terminal operation. So you cannot reuse a stream, you cannot even reuse it after the terminal operation. You cannot do anything with the values after the terminal operation, and you cannot even reuse the stream itself. And if you don't have a terminal operation, if you have only the source and you put it there, even if it has some other operations that we will call intermediary, the stream doesn't execute. So that's an important aspect to be known about streams. So at least the values from the source will go from the source to a terminal operation like this. Now we have this possible situation, but we have also the situation in which we can apply multiple intermediary operations. So instead of having directly the terminal operation as I do here, the terminal operation will be somewhere at the end, but between the source and the terminal operation, the elements will be passing multiple intermediary operations. So I will call these intermediary operations with I. Let's say I1, I2, I3, and so on, because we might have as many intermediary operations as we want. So when you have something like this, the elements will start from the source, and then you will have them first be processed by the first intermediary operation, and then they will, the result, what comes out from the first intermediary operation will go to the second intermediary operation, and then you have the third intermediary operation, again what comes out from the second will go to the third. And then at some point, they have to reach the terminal operation, because remember, there is always a terminal operation, so you cannot avoid having a terminal operation. Without the terminal operation, the stream doesn't execute at all. But the idea is that you might have as many intermediary steps as you want, and this looks very much like a pipeline from production, where you have some raw material at the left, and then you have some operations which you apply on the raw material, and whatever gets out of the first operation goes to the second one, then from the second one to the third one, and at some point the product is finished and the whole process ends. So the way we think about this is precisely on steps, and again, the really important thing to remember, always a source, always a terminal operation, and you might have zero or more intermediary operations. Like in my case, going back to my first example, then you could see there how I have basically used only one intermediary operation, and a terminal operation, of course. So my intermediary operation is the filter, while the terminal operation, again I will call it T here, is for each. So in the case of my example, my first example here, I have the list as the source from where I take out the stream, and then I apply a filter, which is my first intermediary operation and the only one of this example. And then for each, which is of course a terminal operation, because if this wasn't a terminal operation, my stream wasn't executing at all. And I will show you again, I will prove this to you in one of the next examples. So here we again consider, and these are the first functions we discuss. We have the filter as my intermediary operation, and then I have the for each as my terminal operation. Okay, that and of course we can consider the list as being the source. And that of course is what makes a stream. So now we will take multiple examples and try to apply this philosophy to solve different problems with which we will also learn plenty of intermediary and terminal operations. And then you can choose whatever algorithm you need in your application by applying the intermediary and the terminal operations to your application. So that being said, let's go back to our Java application and try a second example. And in the second example, first of all, I want to take into consideration all the possible sources for your streams. So from my point of view, before going to the intermediary and terminal operations, let's see first how can we create a source, which are our possibilities to create a source of elements. So example 2, in my case package example 2, in which I will create the example 2 class, we'll discuss here how to create a source. And first of all, you have already seen we might have a collection. And I will already skip this example where we have a collection, because you have already seen it, so you can just take it as it is from now on. In most of the cases anyway, we will use collections as sources for our stream. But first of all, just take into consideration that we might use any collection as the source for our stream, and this is the first kind of source that you have learned. Then we have the stream class. And the stream class has multiple methods, and maybe the most basic of them all is the stream empty. The stream empty allows you creating an empty stream, which is a stream that contains no elements. So for example, if I want a stream of integers but containing no elements, then I can simply call this static method from the stream interface. Empty will provide me an implementation of stream with no elements. Maybe you wonder, why would we actually need such a stream with no elements? Well, you usually use it to avoid the null values. So you know that using null is generally an anti-pattern, especially receiving and returning null from methods. And we do try to avoid that as much as possible. So that means that if you have, for example, a method returning a list, and you at some point need to return null, which generally means the lack of having values, instead of returning null, so of course you do something in the method here, this method does something, and then you have to return, you have a situation in which you have a lack of elements, you don't have a list. Instead of returning null, of course it's better if you return an empty list. So maybe you will use the collections empty list in this case to return an empty list. Well, the same works with streams. It's better if you have a situation in which you declare a method and that method returns a stream. Then to avoid, of course, using null and to avoid returning null, then it's better if you return an empty stream. And you can create an empty stream with the empty method, similarly to the way you would have created the empty collection here using the static method of the collections class. So that's the main purpose of having an empty stream, is to replace and to avoid using null. We will discuss in one of our future lessons a very interesting class and very important one, starting with Java 8. This class was added to Java 8 and has the meaning of replacing null values in a lot of situations, and we call this optional. Optional is quite a used implementation starting with Java 8, and you will see it used in a lot of situations and a lot of other libraries, frameworks and APIs. So that's why we will discuss it as well in one of our very close future lessons, together with the streams API we are discussing now, because as you will see, even some of the methods from the stream API use the optional class. And that's also related to avoiding the use of nulls. But that's the empty stream, and now you remember this method. I won't, of course, call anything from here, because you can trust me that this is a stream containing no values, so I don't have what to prove you more than this. So the next usage is to use the factory method of, so you can simply create a stream. By the way, I'm using integer, but I could have used string or any other kind of object here, so I'm just using integer for my convenience, but you could use any kind of element if you'd like, instead of integer, any kind of an object there, as long as you have to provide the generic type for the type of the object you use. So if you use, for example, a stream of integer and you have a stream with a finite number of elements that you know from the beginning, very similar to the way I've created my list here in the first example, where I have simply provided the values, then I could have directly created my stream, so I can use the of method, where I simply then have to enumerate the method of, which is this factory method. Having a vararks as a parameter allows me to create a stream with defined elements from the beginning. So if I now, of course, use this stream to put in the console all the values, then you will see the values, exactly the values that I have defined here. So if I run this, you will see in the console. See, this is the situation in which you can see I have used directly the source and the terminal operation. So I have the source and the terminal operation. So I might have no intermediary operations, but I should have at least the source and the terminal operation. And you can see it here, the values I have given. And then we have the possibility to create a stream again using a generator. So this is a nice way to create values. You use the generate method, which is again a static method in the stream interface. As you can see, it receives as a parameter again a functional interface. Again, these functional interfaces, there is a big reason for why we've done them in the previous lesson before starting with the streams API, because you see they are a lot used and you find them a lot in this stream API. So in case you've missed the previous lesson, you can go back anytime and review the video recorded on this same channel. So we need a supplier, and to remind you what a supplier is, it was that functional interface providing a value but without having parameters. The supplier doesn't consume anything, it has no parameters, but it only returns a value, and the generic type of the supplier is the type of the value returned by the supplier. So let's assume I want to create a stream where I randomly generate values, integer values, then I can simply use the generate, and then I have to provide a supplier for the generate. To make it easier to be seen, I will write the supplier above. So supplier of type integer, and Again, the lambda expression, very important, supplier doesn't receive any parameters, so that's why I have no parameters on the left side of the arrow. And then here is where I have to return an integer, because this is what I have provided here as the type of the supplier. And then I can write something like this. I can use the random class from Java util, and then I can use the nextInt method of the random class, and this piece of code here on the right side of the arrow simply creates me a random value. The random class is not the greatest way to use to generate random values, by the way. Take it here only as a very short example. In general, we would basically use the secured random class and some more cryptography into generating some good some good random values that you cannot predict. But for our example, it's more than enough here to use the random class from the Java util, and then I provide the supplier directly as a parameter here to the generate method. So what will the generate method create for me now is a stream that uses this supplier to generate me values continuously. So this is why this we also call a finite source, and this is also finite, and this is an infinite. An infinite source is a source where the values are generated continuously, so it doesn't have a finite number of values. And in our case, S3 is an example, a good example of an infinite stream, because it will continue produce values based on the supplier you provide as a parameter here. So that means that we have to limit it ourselves. So if I would simply do the same thing as I've done here, then basically what will happen is that I will have a forever running application. So an application always running and printing out random numbers, random integers. So I commented out this for each to only see this one as the result, and you will basically see that if I do so, so my application will run continuously generating values in the console, and I will have to stop it manually. So you see, now it produces and it continues to produce random values, random integer values. So I will close it myself here. So what if I would like to have only 10 random values, only 10 values produced with this stream? Can I do something like this? Yes, usually in this case you would use the intermediary operation called limit. So limit is very often used with infinite stream. Of course, you can use it as well with any kind of stream. You can use it with a finite stream as well, but you will often see it used with an infinite stream to limit the number of values of that stream, because otherwise the stream will produce an infinite number of values and you don't usually want that. So let's assume I only want to have 10 such values. I prefer to put my methods one under the other like this. So if I want to have only 10, then I do use the limit here, and then I will only have the first 10 random values produced by this stream, which will be printed in the console. So you run it like this, and then you will see only 10 values instead of the console continuously running and printing out values. So these are my 10 values, and you see the application stopped and I don't have a continuous loop generating values. So that's with limit and how we use it with this kind of infinite streams. What other options do we have? We have the iterate method, of course. Let's try the iterate method as well. So a supplier of integer, for example, in my case will be S4. Then again, not a supplier, sorry, I was defining a stream actually. So a stream in this case, and I will use the iterate method here. And you see we have two iterate methods. Actually, the first one that we see here using the seed and the unary operator I will start with is we have this method starting with Java 8. It was there from Java 8, starting with the first release of the Streams API. The second method you see here basically that has the seed and a predicate and the unary operator, it was added as an enhancement to the Stream API with Java 9. And it's one of those additions I was discussing about at the beginning of this lesson that came with Java 9. But after Java 9, then I don't remember they've added anything new to the Stream API, so at least not to the Stream interface. So let's try them out. Let's start with the first one, the iterate. Let's say I have a definition that starts with an 1. And then an unary operator. Do you remember what an unary operator was? It's again one of those 9 core interfaces from the Java util function we discussed in the previous lesson. An unary operator is like a function, but it consumes a value of a type and it returns a value of the same type. So it's again a more particular way of a function. The function consumes a value of a type and might return a value of a different type, but the unary operator, consumed value and the return value have always the same type. So that's how the unary operator works. So in my case, I consume I, and I know this I is basically an integer, and I know it's an integer because this is the type I have chosen here for my stream. So I consume an integer and then I have to return an integer as well. So for example, a good implementation of a unary operator could be this one where we increment the value. And this is also a good example of an infinite stream. So this stream will actually start from the value 1, which we call the seed, and then we'll use this unary operator to generate always the next value. So it applies the unary operator on the previous value to generate the next value. So that means that it starts with 1 and then the next value will be 2, because this is what our unary operator do. Our unary operator does is incrementing the value, and then the next one will be 3, and then the next one will be 4, and so on and so forth. So again, being an infinite stream, I can choose to directly print it, but if I do something like this, then what I'll have is actually an infinite running application, because it will forever print until probably at some point it overflows this integer. And to limit this, I will have the same approach as I have done in the previous example with the generate, where I can use the limit intermediary method and specify the maximum number of values I want to be consumed from the source. So in this case, I will only print the first 10 values. So let's run the application and see what happens. And I expect to see the first 10 values generated for this from this stream, which start with the seed, and then each of the next values represent the value generated by applying the unary operator to the previous value. So in our case, incrementing the value with 1, because this is what we have done here. So this is how iterate works actually, and this is the fourth option of a stream that I did provide you. And then we have the other iterate that came with Java 9. So we have a stream and we have an integer and I have S5 here. And again, we have a stream and we use the iterate. And we use this iterate, our T type again will be integer in this case, because this is what I have chosen. And then I have to specify a predicate, and this predicate will decide if I have to stop or not. So it's like a for loop, if you want to think in terms of a for loop. It's like you have the definition of the seed, and then you have the condition, represented here by a predicate, because a predicate is evaluated with true or false. That's a predicate, is that function that consumes a value and then evaluates if true and or false. And then you have the unary operator. So we can do something like this. I start with the seed, which is an 1, and then we apply a condition on I. Let's say I should be smaller than 10 or smaller or equal, doesn't matter. And then you have the third parameter here, which is the unary operator, which can be again increment. So this is how it looks like, and it looks pretty strange with a lot of arrows. I don't really like this method the way it looks like. I feel this all these symbols dance in front of my eyes, and it becomes difficult to read them. And be very careful, because this kind of syntaxes, they are very, very often encountered in the OCP 11 certification exam. So when you see a lot of symbols and they are very, written in a way in which it makes difficult to read, those kind of syntaxes are the ones that you will find in your OCP in your OCP 11 exam questions. So maybe it's better if we put them one under the other and we see them like this. So we start from seed 1, and then we have the condition that the value should be smaller than 10, and then we have the increment that will be applied. And I can basically directly use the for each here, because this is no longer a finite, an infinite, this is a finite stream source. So I can apply directly the for each on the stream, and it should end at some point when my value reaches 11, and this is no longer the predicate doesn't any longer return a true. So let's run it and see the result. And yes, we have the values from 1 to 10, of course, because when it reached 11, the condition of the predicate didn't match anymore, and then the stream stopped. Again, this is starting with Java 9. It's important to know this in case you are going to the OCP 8. If you are still, I don't recommend that, but if you are still going to the OCP 8 exam, then you won't see this method. This is only starting with Java 9, which means you will see it for your OCP 11 exam, but not for the OCP 8 exam. Okay, and I think we have managed to discuss all the possibilities to have stream sources. So we discussed about generate, iterate, the factory method, we discussed about the empty, and we discussed about having sources from collections. And probably in most of the cases, these are the main possibilities you will encounter either in your OCP certification exam or in real world scenarios. So with that being said, and we have time left, let's go with example 3 and try to discuss more of the intermediary and terminal methods. And of course, what we don't manage to discuss now, we will continue with the next in the next lesson. I was already prepared that we won't manage to finish everything regarding streams in one lesson, and we'll probably not finish them even in two, because again, this is a really, really big subject. And you, if you wish to know all the details about Stream API, you have to spend a lot of time learning these methods and trying a lot of examples to understand them. And I wouldn't recommend you go at least to your OCP 11 exam or OCP 8 exam without knowing Streams API very, very well, because you will find plenty of questions dealing with the Streams API in that exam. And again, being that is really, really important. So why when is better to use stream instead of collection? Well, starting with the first example here, thank you very much, Cosmin, for your question. So starting with the first example we had here, when you have such algorithms, such code snippets, where you do processing on a collection, in most of the cases, you can rewrite them with streams. So when you have such a small piece of code, of course, I've started with that, it's not really visible that the code becomes easier to read, because here we have anyway three lines, and you can read it. This one is so simple that you can read it as well, very, very easy, despite the fact that we have less curly braces and less words and symbols. You don't see a great advantage with a small piece of code. But when the processing on the collection becomes larger, so when you have a bigger algorithm, not only a few lines of code, the bigger the algorithm is, the easier is to read. So the bigger the difference is between writing it like this and writing it with the Stream API. So to answer your question, in general, I would choose a Stream basically anytime I have such an algorithm implying operation on a collection. Instead of writing it like this, I prefer to write it like this because it becomes very easy to read. All you simply read it like poetry. You see, from the list I filter out all the elements that don't respect this condition, and then I do this for each of them. So you can read it like a normal phrase. When the algorithm grows, then it's even bigger the difference, where you don't understand it very easy written in such a way, but you understand it directly much easier, even 10 times faster if you write it with streams. Streams are not about performance, so if with streams you might even implement algorithms slower. So if what you need is performance, then you might need to avoid streams. Actually, you might need to draw back to this way of working and find the best algorithm to write a more performant solution. But when it comes to maintainability on a collection, I would always choose writing it with streams because it's really, really easy to read. So that's the answer. That's my answer to your question. In example two, again, we have finished with the second example, and that's where we discussed the possibility to have sources. And then we will create a third example here. And in the third example, we start with the intermediary and terminal operations that you need to know, from fundamentals, from basics, up to more advanced. And let's create a third class, example three here, with our main method, of course. And then we will discuss a few of the methods, starting with the beginning. Let's say the methods methods that first rely on operations. No, I would say not necessarily intermediate or terminal. Maybe we take them one by one, and we make sure that we don't miss anything. Anyway, I did prepare here, by the way, I almost forgot, I did prepare here directly the documentation, and that is because I want to make sure that I take all the needed methods that I want to discuss with you. And some of them, we will not take them in this order, because this is not the right order in which you will understand them very concisely. But we will use the documentation to make sure that I didn't skip any of them, because as you will see, they are a lot. Of course, you don't need to know absolutely all the methods here. We don't need to test absolutely all of them, but most of them you need to know, and that's why I will make sure with this that I won't skip any important method. So let's say for the beginning, all match, any match, and none match. You don't see none match here, but there is a none match. They are in alphabetical order, and that's why you don't see it. It's here. So I take these three first, and I will show you these three methods first: all match, any match, and none match. I will take the three are very related one to the other, so that's why I take these two and the one that is at the end of the list. And they are terminal operations, and some of those that you need to know and understand. So for example, I have a list again. I have this list, I will copy paste from my first example so I don't have to rewrite it. And I will apply any match on the stream. Of course, I have to apply it. I will apply any match, all match, and none match. These terminal methods receive a predicate and they all return a boolean. Any match applies the predicate and it returns true in case at least one of the values matches the predicate. All match receives also a predicate and it returns true if all the values match the predicate. And none match receives a predicate and returns true only if none of the values match the predicate. So in my case, let's assume the predicate is also referring again to odd and even numbers. So let's assume I have this predicate that tests if a value is even, and I will get all the return values, all the booleans for any match, all match and none match in this example. The three methods are really easy to understand because and they are very close as functionality one to the other. Any match in this case will tell me that there is at least an even value, because there is at least a value that for which the predicate will return true. So if we have at least one, then the method will return true. And then we have the all match, which of course will return false, and the none match, which of course will return false again, because there is at least one value that doesn't match the predicate, which is actually the first one, and the opposite for it, there is at least a value matching it. So in the case of all match and none match, either all of the values should match the predicate so that a true is returned, or in the case of the none match, all the values shouldn't match the predicate so a true is returned. So that's pretty easy to understand, but what's more important to remember about this is actually how they rely when using them with infinite stream sources. So of course in this case it's pretty easy to understand them. We have run them on a list with finite number of values, and we know what happens, and then they will return the expected values. But what happens when we have an infinite source? So for example, what happens if I have an iterate, like in the case of the second example? We can take precisely this one I have defined here, or it can be this one, generate, which is even trickier. So in this case, we at least know that the values will be in order, and of course they don't stop. So what happens in this case if I will choose to apply the AnyMatch method? The question is, if I apply AnyMatch, will this stream actually stop? Will this stop at some point? Well, in case of this stream, it will basically stop at some point, and that will be precisely, it will stop when it reaches the second value, which is 2, because 2 will match, and then if at least one of them matches the predicate, then any match will stop and will return true. But any match not always is not always stopping the stream. So imagine if I, instead of this stream, if I would have had a stream that was iterating with on a step of 2, then this basically would have generated me the only odd values. And so on. So in this case, if we apply for S2 the any match, will this actually end at some point? Well, it basically won't end, because the any match will try continuously to find a value that matches the predicate, and the stream never ends. And but not only that it never ends, but you will never get to such a value for which the predicate is true. So any match will run continuously, in this case will create an infinite loop. So in case of S1, any match doesn't create an infinite loop. It will stop at the second value, where it finds the value that matches the predicate and will return true. But for the second stream, the same any match method will continuously loop and will never end, because it will never reach a value that for which the predicate returns true. But it will continuously hope to find one, so it will run infinitely for each of the values returned by this stream. So this is something to take into consideration, and something that I have actually even found in the OCP 8 exam a long time ago when I have taken that certification. So so take this into consideration on how these methods apply on infinite streams. Imagine I would have had actually the generate. Can we say something about the generate here? Well, we can assume that at some point the value returned will be even. There are anyway 50-50 chances. But can we actually say when that will happen? This is a very interesting case, because we know that most probably the generate method will generate at some point an even value, and then using any match will stop the stream. But we don't know when that will happen. So that means that we don't know precisely how many elements will be generated by the source until the stream stops. It can be one, or it can be 1,000, depending on when the even value is actually generated. So you see how these methods, their functionality is really dependent on the values on the source. And you have to keep that in mind and take that into consideration. So the old match and the non-match, the same things we can say about them. Of course, the logic is a little bit different. But if you look attentively, you will see that, for example, in the old match case, well, if at some point the method receives a value that where the predicate doesn't match, it will automatically return false and the stream will end. But if there is no value where the predicate is not respected, then like on an infinite source, you generate only odd, only even values. Sorry, here in this case, then the method will continuously evaluate each of the values, trying to see if all of them match. But all of them means an infinite all of them, so you will never stop. It creates an infinite loop. And the same logic might apply for the non-match. So you will find in all the cases of this method situations when applying them on infinite sources, stream sources, they might end the stream at a specific point, or you might not know exactly when the stream ends, or they might run continuously. And such questions you can find them in your OCP exam. And that's why take them into consideration. Remember these aspects before going to your OCP exam. Okay, we don't have a lot of time to spare, but I guess we have discussed a lot of things today. So we have started with the first example, and we have done a very, very small comparison between how to write the code without having streams to process elements of a list, and then we have we had a taste on how this works with having the stream API used for the same thing, and then we discussed plenty of possibilities besides having the values from a list. We discussed plenty of possibilities to generate stream sources that you again need to know and understand at least before going to your OCP exam. And then we have ended by discussing how the any match, all match, and non match work. So not directly related to streams, but could you please explain a bit weak references in Java and when it would be useful? Wow, this is a totally unrelated subject. I will try to explain it very fast, but I guess it works with having a specific different video for that, because it's not an easy subject. So in general, references in Java, they are strong references, which means that the garbage collector will not collect an instance if it finds at least one reference for that instance. So you know the instances, they are stored in a heap, and garbage collector collects them. So what happens is that the garbage collector won't collect any kind of instance if there is at least one reference. And you might have multiple references even from different threads in an application. So that is called, and that's what a normal reference is a strong reference, and that's what you basically create almost any time in your application, 99.9999% of cases, your references are strong references. So are those kind of references for which if there is at least one garbage collector won't collect it from the memory. Now there is what you call a weak reference that you can create and you have to explicitly create it for an object. When you create a weak reference, however, the reference is not taken into consideration by the garbage collector, which means that you have a reference to the object, but even though you have a reference, the garbage collector can still collect the instance from the memory. So you might have a reference then to an object that doesn't exist anymore. And there are also phantom references. But to detail more than this subject, I really need more than 5 minutes or 10 minutes because again it's a really complex one. But I hope that you at least have an idea what these are. So strong references, most of our references are strong. When you have at least one, object cannot be collected from the memory. Weak references, you can create them explicitly for an object, but when you create a weak reference, then you cannot be sure that the object won't be collected, because if an object only has weak references, then the garbage collector can decide to collect it from the memory when space is needed. So when it garbages out the instances, if weak references exist, then it will take them out. Okay, can a stream throw handle an exception? Can a stream throw handle an exception? I guess you mean the function inside the stream, so something like this. Let's try to take it now, but of course, being that we will discuss about streams in the next couple of lessons, probably we will probably detail on that anyway more in the future lessons. But I want to at least answer it shortly, let's say. So example 4, and we have the main method, and I guess you mean something like this. Let's assume you have the same collection I have here, and then you probably refer to what happens if I have somewhere in the stream, then you might have multiple operations here, other operations. We will see more complex examples with multiple operations in the next lessons. And at some point you have a method, it can be the terminal one or an intermediary one, and then you have an exception thrown somehow. And basically this doesn't happen directly here, but in most of the cases you have a method, and this method throws an exception at some point. So let's say if x is an even number, then throw an exception. So the idea is that what you have to know about this situation, so let's say I have it here, I actually call m of x. Okay, I can have something like this. What you have to take into consideration regarding these situations is that you won't be able to put the try catch here. So be attentive not to surround the entire stream with the try catch, because that's not what it happens. So remember that we here call from the for each method, this will be called and the exception will be thrown out from the M directly where it's called inside the for each method. So if you want to try to catch this exception, you will have to catch it up to the level of the lambda expression, so not outside of the expression itself. So that's still valid for if you use runtime exceptions or if we refer to checked exceptions. And it might be even more visible when you have checked exceptions, because when you have checked exceptions, and of course then you have to throw them out from the method itself, it automatically shows you that the exception needs to be caught here at the lambda exception at most. So you can't catch the exception like this because it's not thrown at the level of the stream, but it's thrown inside the stream. So it's basically thrown in the for each method, which will call the lambda expression, which will call this consumer, which actually it's implemented by calling the my method that throws the exception. So see, by putting the try catch, surrounding the try catch, surrounding the whole stream with the try catch, doesn't solve the problem. So it doesn't solve the problem because my exception is not thrown out of the stream. You will have to treat it here, not outside. So that's one of the things I've seen, one of the mostly encountered confusions about streams. Okay, I'm glad this was precisely what you wanted. So yes, just this is what to be remembered. When you throw an exception like this, it's inside the stream where we treat it, and this is easiest to prove with a checked exception, because you can see precisely here that I have thrown my exception and it's still not compiling. And the reason why it's not compiling, and my IntelliJ tells me that, unhandled exception, because even if I added this try catch here surrounding the stream itself, it's not treating the exception, because the exception is here and inside the for each, and this is where you can treat it. Super, thank you very much for your questions. Thank you very much for attending the stream again. And we just started with Streams API. We have plenty of methods to discuss. We have the primitive streams as well to discuss. And then we have to discuss the optional class and match the optional class with the Stream API chapter as well. So a few lessons from now on, we'll be discussing about streams, optional, and things related to streams. So stay tuned for that. Thank you very much for your attendance, and have a great time for study further.